Hey everybody, what's up and welcome back. If you're new here, I'm Liz, your host here at Crimes Untold. And for today, we're going to be talking about some more unidentifieds that have been identified as of 2023. Now, if you're new here, I'm just your simple person that likes to talk about some true crime. So don't forget to like, subscribe, and turn your post notifications on to all that way you know whenever I upload. So let's kind of dive into our true crime cases today, shall we? So first one on our list used to be known as the St. Tammany Jane Doe. We're talking about Paula Ann Boudreaux. So Paula Ann Boudreaux went missing on August 3rd of 1989 in Golden Meadow, Louisiana. And she would be discovered on March 13th of 1989. And her remains would be found by some hunters in a remote wooded location in Slidell, Louisiana. Her death still remains under investigation due to her death being a possible homicide. And also, the state of her remains caused the manner of death. It couldn't be determined because of the state of her remains. It was hard for the medical examiner to definitively say exactly what killed her. Her remains were skeletal when she was found. She was believed to be about 4'11 to 5'2 in height and about 18 to 30 years old. Also, it's believed that she was mixed race, Caucasian, maybe with some African American ancestry. Here's kind of the thing is that this is all the transcripts have for information about the St. Tammany Jane Doe. There's not a lot more about her. Now, obviously, she was identified as Paula Ann Boudreaux in April of 2023. So if you or anyone you know has any information in regards to her cold case, please contact the St. James Parish Coroner's Office at 225-869-3493. Again, if you or anyone you know has any information in regards to the St. Tammany Jane Doe, please contact the St. James Parish's Coroner's Office at 225-869-3493. Next, we're going to be discussing Patricia Anderson. So on November 14th of 2020, a woman was found unresponsive outside of an abandoned home in Indianapolis near Michigan Street. She had blue eyes, shoulder-length brown hair that had some spots of gray streaks in it, some freckles with a 5-inch scar on the front of her abdomen as well. So she was taken to Community East Hospital, where she later would succumb to her injuries. Her injuries were caused by hypothermia, and her death was ruled accidental. This Jane Doe would be added to NAMIS in April of 2021 as UP79956, but no matches were made after she was added to NAMIS. In 2023, the Marion County Coroner's Office wanted to look into the option of forensic genetics to identify this woman. So with the help of Othram, they were able to identify this woman as Patricia Anderson. It is unclear as to how or why she ended up in Indianapolis due to her being from California. Next, we're going to be talking about Jack Langeneckert. His last name is very interesting the way it's spelled, so I'll put it on the screen for you to see. So 38 years after he was found on June 11th of 1984, this John Doe was identified on March 29th of 2023 as Jack Langeneckert. He was dressed in a pinstripe suit that was thought to be, extremely tall, about 6 feet to 6'2". So about today's standards, that's kind of like a, I would say that's kind of like a normal range for like the taller side of a male, but that's just my opinion. He had a black comb, a handkerchief, and a gold money clip in his pocket. He was found in Troy, about 5 miles east of the highway, in a pump house on a farm. It was determined that he died about 6 months prior to being found. So for all intents and purposes, this John Doe was dressed very well. Very expensive items he was wearing all the way down to the gold money clip. Super fancy. You would think that this would aid in identifying him, but nothing came of the initial investigation. In 2016, they tried to do a DNA match with a DNA extraction, but there was no matches made. But later, with genetic materials, they would able to be to determine that this was Jack Langeneckert. He was born in 1931 in Missouri. He was a real estate agent in Florissant. I believe that's the the way you pronounce it. I'll put it on the screen as well. And that one day he went to work, he was never seen again. He was 50 years old at the time of his death. So about a week after his disappearance, his car was found. Obviously, he wasn't found with it. This case is still active. We do know that his cause of death is a gunshot wound, but why is unknown, and they are hopeful to be able to find out who killed this man. On June 19th of 1970, two men were hiking east of the Independence Pass summit when they came across something gruesome. A set of decomposed remains were alongside the road in a ditch. A rock had fallen and covered the torso of the remains. They also noticed that his arm and rib cage was missing. His left arm, to be exact. But this would later be determined that it more than likely was ripped off due to a snowplow running over or hitting the remains. Yeah, and then obviously this was done post-mortem due to the disarticulation of the remains. This set of remains had $7 in his pants pocket along with a razor. His pants were a light wash, and he was wearing a pair of loafers that were black, but this differs from what the newspaper says. So, the newspaper indicates that this man was wearing gray pants or gray slacks, had either tennis or hiking shoes on, three pairs of socks, I don't know why three pairs of socks, but, and a wrecked t-shirt or wrecked sweatshirt. Two polar opposite depictions and descriptions of the clothes found on these remains. Strange. So during the autopsy, it was determined that this male was between 18 to 30, about 120 to 150 pounds, and had brown hair and was 5'6 to 5'8 in height, so a relatively, like, normal or average size Joe. Eye color couldn't be determined due to the state of decomposition, and other distinguishable markings couldn't be determined as well due to the state of the body. However, they were able to determine or to do a kind of like a set or like an impression of dental records. That way they could see if potentially this could match somebody or maybe check dentist's office. But unfortunately, due to bad record keeping, the records, we don't know where they are. These dental impressions, the ones that were taken, we have no idea. But I digress. So in April of 2013 is when the body would, they would be hopeful to exhume the body, and fingerprints were taken by the CBI. DNA would be extracted at this time, and this would be at the University of Northern Texas, using the skull and the femur. With the help of advancements in genetic forensics, they would be able to identify this John Doe future time with this. I will say that this John Doe has two names. Either he's called the Modesto Man or the Independence Pass John Doe. These were the two monikers that were given to him until he would be identified on February 17th, 2023, publicly as Gardner Paul Smith. Gardner Paul Smith was an Olympic skier that had gone missing in 1968. No one knew what happened to him to cause his disappearance other than that he was in terrible physical shape around the time he disappeared, unfortunately, and it is suspected that his death is accidental. The body of a nude male would be extracted from a creek in Fayette County, Ohio, on November 17th of 1981. This male was determined to have wounds that looked like he was carved open with a knife and had two through and through bullet wounds made by a smaller caliber. Also noticeable about this male's body is that he had a tanning pattern that would be more commonly found in a warmer climate. During his autopsy, they were able to determine that he was 5'5 in height, about 130 pounds, between the ages of 16 to 25, and that he was Caucasian, but possibly Hispanic. He had an olive complexion to his skin, so that's why they were... Does he have a Spanish ancestry? Is he just primarily white? He had green eyes and he had light curly brown hair. He also seemed to have two surgical scars that were vertical located on his lower left abdomen. So the thing that was really strange about these is that there was no suture marks, hence leading them to believe he never had stitches for these. So one was about 3.4 inches in length, and the other one was 1.7 inches in length. To me, thinking about the size of these are, I mean, he was stabbed, but he never had stitches to close them, so it's a little strange. And yeah, it's just, there's a scar line, but there's no suture marks. So for me, it's like really, really, really odd. So there is no technical cause of death for him that's listed, so it remains unknown, even though most of the sources list that he died via a gunshot wound or death by homicide via gunshots. Yeah. The transcriptions for this John Doe, some of them say unknown for death, and others say death by homicide of gunshot wounds. So either record keeping is kind of like strange, or people just don't know how to, you know, relay what the actual cause of death is. Anywho, I digress. So they do believe he died within 24 hours of being found. So this to me makes sense due to us being able to understand and know what his eye color is. So like I've previously mentioned before, when somebody dies, their eye color, the pigment goes away. And it's after a certain amount of time after they die, that's when the pigment basically leaves their eyes. They become lifeless in their eyes. So we know his eye color, which is nice. So this John Doe would be eventually identified on February 27, 2023, that of 19-year-old Theodore Long. Theodore Long went missing from Toledo, Ohio in the 70s. There is not much known about when he went missing leading up to his death, unfortunately. So last for today's video, we're going to be talking about the Aurora Woman. So a set of skeletal remains were found in an abandoned Rustcraft greeting card building in Joliet, Illinois. This set of skeletal remains were found amongst a junk pile on May 13th of 1997. So this was after an archaeologist found a human bone in a landfill in Rockdale, Illinois. So the debris they found in the landfill was actually from the Rustcraft building, which led them to look in this building, hence why they found this set of skeletal remains. So this building was set to be demolished following a fire that happened in 1992. Well, in 97, they were clearing out the building, and this is when they found the remains. There was no cause of death that could be determined, but it's suspected that she didn't die in the fire that happened in 1992. And more than likely that she had expired prior to 1986, so she's been in this building for a while. Her examination led to the assumption that she was African American, but during her isotope testing that Othram had conducted, it revealed that she had grown up in northern United States or in Canada, and that she was Caucasian and there was no roots of African American ancestry. This female was determined to be about 15 to 24 of age and was between 5 feet to 5'10 in height. So very, very wide or large range, basically. This case would sit until 2009 when the cold case unit was formed in Will County, and they started working on this case and other cold cases in hopes of identifying them. DNA would be extracted and it would be entered into the NAMIS directory as UP5206. And then this was searched into CODIS and added into CODIS, but there was no hits. So no identification at this time. There was some leads that they were able to look into, but they eventually were eliminated, unfortunately. So this brings us to 2022, when the DNA in this case would be sent to Othram for DNA testing. This Doe would be identified as that of Marie R. O'Brien on March 3rd, 2023. She disappeared in 1984 from Aurora, Illinois. If you or anyone you know has any information in regards to Marie R. O'Brien, please contact the Will County Coroner's Office at 815-727-8455 using the reference UN97-01. Again, if you or anyone you know has any information in regards to Marie R. O'Brien, please contact the Will County Coroner's Office at 815-727-8455 using the reference of UN97-01. So that, my friends, is today's video of unidentifieds that have been identified in 2023. I hope you guys enjoyed, and I will see you guys in my next one.